Thank you, Glenn. Sorry for rushing you, but I think you highlighted very interesting points. And colleagues, I urge you, if you have any comments for Glenn, just jot them down. And after Carlos, we'll just quickly do a round of discussions, and he may also elaborate on some of the issues that he skipped. Carlos?
Maximize that energy and to dimension the system to keep the cost as low as possible, because again we learned that the income is an issue and we want to keep the solutions as cheap as possible. We want to maximize the generation of energy and to maximize or minimize the cost of the solution. So aligning the solar panels to get the maximum energy is tricky. You need to align it to the north. If you are in the southern hemisphere, you need to align it to the south. If you are in the northern hemisphere, and then depending on your latitude, you are going to have to tilt it to get the maximum energy. Throughout the year, you have to change a couple of times a year, because in summer and in winter, you can maximize the energy generation. That requires knowledge, that requires materials, that requires tools, and that requires a lot of time. And as I said, there are costs related to the sizing of the solar panel. And also, again, the impact of the local market. If you want to do that, because every single roof in Mancosi is facing a different direction and is tilted in a completely different way, we have to come up with a wooden structure to actually align it to maximize this solar production, which requires bolts and nuts and a battery power drill and this and that, and that actually finding this in the local market is actually very tricky, which again adds up time and adds up cost because it's not available. But the energy that we generate, it needs to be stored somewhere, and that's the batteries, right? That's what we use to store the energy. Again, the size and the batteries, the size of the batteries and its cost is completely related. The bigger the battery, the more you have to spend. Then there are other parameters that you need to take into account. As Glenn was saying, what are the loads that we are going to be using? How big are we going to dimension our system? How many days of autonomy are we going to take into consideration? How many days without sun are we going to dimension our system to work with? So all that stuff we need to take into account. And again, you need knowledge, you need time, you need etc. Then it comes the lifespan of the batteries. The more you use, it requires maintenance to not over discharge the battery and not overcharge the battery, because that kills and reduces the battery life. The temperature as well at which the system is operating also influences on the battery life. So there are many considerations to take into account when you are dimensioning this or choosing the battery that you want to use. And also it needs to be handled with care. I don't know if you have seen a battery blowing or a battery catching fire or getting short circuited because you connect the negative with the positive. Well, that happens. And that happens when people without that much knowledge or without knowing the risk of handling batteries play with this type of technologies. These technologies are storing a lot of energy and therefore can be damaging. And disposing them has, or not disposing them properly, has a lot of implication. For instance, if there are wells or if the water can be polluted, there are the air can be corrupted if it gets certain temperature, etc., etc. So choosing the battery, the size, etc., has some implications. Also, for not over-discharging and overcharging the batteries, we need a regulator. Again, there are different types of regulators. There are pulse wave modulation, and there is maximum power point regulators. They are different in price and they are different in efficiency. Then we need to choose, as again Glenn was saying, between the cables, which size of the cables are we going to use, which fuses are we going to use. This is a picture from my PhD from Cincinnati. Most of the failures that, in this case, Jay had to repair were related to fuses and cables. So actually, you can dimension the system perfectly, but still there is a lot of maintenance that goes into changing cables and changing fuses. And then it comes the loads. How many loads are we going to use? How much is the consumption of those loads? How many hours are those loads going to be powered, etc., etc. In the case of Cincinnati and in the case of many other areas, it's not about the road in itself. There are some other non-priority loads that actually in Mancosi are being critical, like for instance the charging of the phones and providing LED lights as incentives for those guys that are keeping these systems in their houses. So we set up a proposal to make all this easier. Easier to install, faster to install, cheaper to design, etc., etc. And we got some funding from the Technology Innovation Agency of South Africa. The whole idea was to build a system that easy to install and maintain, that was flexible, that was able to maximize the energy harvest, that was pre-dimensioned for different scenarios, that maximized the lifespan, that allowed the communication with the router, and that has cost as a configuration, as part of it. As cheap as possible. So for now we've developed this, well, it has several components, it has a bracket, it has the power supply, and it has the cables and the solar panel and all that. So the bracket, this bracket can be set up with only one spanner, a 13 spanner. The rest are cable ties, and you can actually get the tilt that you want. You can change the tilt for different tilts that you may need in different parts of Africa, and you can point to the north just with a GPS and a magnet. Almost every smartphone has a magnet now that can be configured to take into account the declination, the magnetic declination, and actually face it north. And if you want to actually take into account the different tilts that actually maximize the power throughout the year, it's very easy, again, with a single spanner to just vary this tilt. You can get up to 10 or 15% more energy throughout different times of the year just by changing the tilt of your solar panel. So the easiest you may, in ours, again, in this, it was impossible to modify the tilt. So you have a full year one and you do your best. But this, with this one, you actually have the possibility to maximize that energy higher. So the other thing that we are doing is that we are collaborating with Freyfunk, with one of its developers called Electra, that is probably the best known female hacker in the world, in the community network space, that has developed an open maximum PowerPoint tracker that is open design, open software, and open hardware. We are upgrading her design to actually be able to use an MPPT. An MPPT actually allows you, by tracking or by increasing the amperage that goes into the battery, you can get as much as 30% more than with a pulse width modulation regulator. Flexibility. The design actually allows for different outputs, like a prioritized output that would be the router with both a 12 volts PoE and a mounting screws in case you want to plug in something else on the prioritized load, in case you don't want to use it for a router or for something else, and then a non-prioritized port for LED lights, phone charging, etc. It allows for different input, because you may have a grid that is unstable, so and you don't want to invest on the panel, so you can just use a grid power that, with a surge protector, you can actually keep the batteries on the stage that they are charged using the grid, and then when the grid goes off, then the battery is there to power your devices. And then it allows for different chemistries that can be configured by software, by the router. Sulfate, iron sulfate, lithium ion, lead acid, etc. It's pre-dimensioned. We have come up with a pre-dimensioning for different scenarios, with a 20 amps hour live sulfate battery and with a 90 watts solar panel. This battery allows us for 3 days of autonomy of powering a low power router like the Mesh Potato, TP-Links, or any other router that has one single radio, and some additional power for the non-priority loads. Or also in the context of the bigger router, it would allow it to power it for 3 days when we use the power efficiency module that probably Nico will describe tomorrow. This Libre router, as it will be described tomorrow, comes with 3 radios and is pretty flexible in terms of networking capacities. But also, it will allow to parallel different power supply units of these 20 amps hour batteries to do 2 times what we are saying above, or to have 3 days of autonomy of a Libre router without the power efficiency module and some power for the non-priority loads, or other configurations like being able to charge a computer and some other things. We've also taken into consideration how to maximize the lifespan. By monitoring the temperature, we are not going to allow the battery to charge or to discharge when the battery in the when the temperature in the room is above 40 degrees. We are gonna allow that the power of the router is cut off at night, in case you can configure it by hardware. If you are not planning to use the router, let's say in between 1 and 5 in the morning, you can send a signal because there is a microcontroller on the power supply unit that will reduce will power of the router, so you are saving on that power every night, and with that you will extend the life of the battery, because the life of the battery depends on the number of cycles of charging and discharging. There will be 2 setups for each battery chemistry in case you want a higher capacity but shorter service life, or a reduced capacity and a longer service life. As you can see on that graph there, the number of cycles is depending on how much you are allowing, you are charging your battery, or you are discharging your battery. And it will also allow to disconnect the priority and the non-priority loads at different voltages of your battery. So that will allow to cut off the non-priority loads before the priority loads and leaving the router, but not allowing more phone charging or more LED lights or this stuff. So the design life of all the project components, in particular the battery, is for at least 5 years, but aiming for 10 years. But even the rest of the components could just be kept and substitute the battery if that if the case comes to those 5 years. The cost, that is the last, it's not the last, but we are working on a first prototype around $270. This is a prototype and we are getting one thing at a time that obviously doesn't make it cost effective. The bracket is around $25. The iron sulfate battery is around $112. The solar panel around $90. And the MPPT with the bills of materials is around $20. Other things like the casing, the cabling, the fuses is around like $23. This price will come down considerably when we manage to establish economies of scale. The whole idea is to make it happen, not to make money about it. That everything we do from the University of the Western Cape is to produce solutions so community networks can thrive. It's not that we are making any money out of this. It was a problem that we were facing when trying to assist sensor ID networks, and we believe that this is a solution that we are going to be using because actually meets our own needs. So community networks are about the people. Electricity is key for the network. So the easier and cheaper that it is to power the network, the more time and resources can be used to build the community. So let's all together, technology designers and the like, keep reducing the barriers to make this happen. Thank you very much.